42 years since the 9th Street Show was organized by some artists of the New York School. Today I'd like to ask you to recall the period, to recall the beginnings of the New York School, some of the things, the influences from the 1930s, the groups that were organized, like the American Abstract Artists, people like Hans Hofmann, who was very influential, and some of you, I think, studied with him, and perhaps the presence of the Surrealists in New York City as well during the war. I'd first like to spend a little time letting you discuss the beginnings of the New York School, and then talk a little bit about how it's been documented since 1951. Ibram, would you like to mention a little bit about your experience with the American Abstract Artists?
Well, about 1934-35, a few of us living in the village, Greenwich Village, of course, nowadays, would get together and talk about abstract art. So, Byron Brown, Alice Mason, among those. And we would, in fact, we first began to meet in my studio. And so after about a year, about 1936, we formed, by this time we added some more names, George L.K. Morris, and Gallatin, and Schauer, and Susie Freilinghuis, and Jerome Klein. Anyway, he wrote about the show, and at the end he said, he predicted, he said, of course, nothing will ever come of this.
Most of the critics criticized the work for being looking too much like European artists, yeah. Too much like Miro or Monet.
Now, some of the American Abstract Artists had been students of Hans Hofmann. Let's discuss Hofmann was teaching. What made Hofmann such an important disseminator of modernism in America?
I first met Hans Hofmann in 34, where he was teaching at the famous school in Gloucester.
So on.
You remember that?
So on.
The difference between the abstract movement, as I saw it, and as I differed with him, there were two schools. There was the non-objective approach. It came from the Bauhaus point of view. It was held by Albers. Albers went to the extent of putting behind each canvas a formula how he arrived at the canvas, at his paintings. You had, on the other hand, Hofmann came here, I don't know the exact date, but in 34.
He came to 31 to California.
31. He went to Berkeley, yeah.
He went to Berkeley in 31. And then he came to the Art Students League in 32.
That's right, and then he opened up his own school. Where the old college art used to be, on Lexington and 57th Street. Hofmann believed that all art stems from nature. The school that formed it together tended to be to theorize, it came from the brain. Hofmann's whole approach was it came from the gut. There were two complete different schools. When AAA was founded, you had the two groups, and you still have them.
Okay, I'd like to ask some of the other people that worked with Hofmann what their experience was with him, how his approach to teaching, and how it affected their own work.
I went to Hofmann's after 2 years with Ozenfahn. I found that Hofmann was liberating. He was openness. He was Apollonian, and was something marvelous about what happened there. Like you said,
he wasn't analytical.
Oh yes, he was. You read his book on painting, and he's very dramatic and quite analytic in a certain way. But also he He pursued the idea of freedom. And you mentioned that he didn't speak English well. I think that's an interesting way of putting it.
And push and pull. All he was trying to show is that there is movement.
Who were on WPA, who were working in various schools of thought, and when they got together and heard about the Hofmann School, joined the class.
Well,
we had
a different.
No, I know it's
right.
A different thing. But you see, to answer your question, one really didn't have to understand his work because of the demonstrations that he made on the work itself, and by showing what your work was in the direction your work was taking, and the direction he felt it should be seen or felt, you were able to see the difference. You didn't need a verbal language for this type of illustration.
Well, I'd like to say, I'd say it was much more visceral. I mean, that's how I would put it, because, you know, if you were to ask me, what did he teach you? I don't know what the hell he taught me.
What period are you talking about?
I'm talking about the early 50s. And
I'm talking about the early
30s. That's it. That's a big difference.
Yeah.
When you got him already, Hofmann was a pro.
He was what?
He was a pro teacher. He was making money.
That's true. Yeah, we have the veterans there. There we go. But the thing is, you see, another very important thing about it is that he seemed to attract eager students. And interesting, another very interesting, this is not a put down, but another attraction to the Hofmann School is at the League, we heard that if you went to Hofmann's class, your material allowance, you got $20 instead of the League gave you $15. So that was a big attraction. I mean, it attracted. But let me say this, that it did attract a core. When I was there, Larry Rivers was there, Alan Capro, Lester Johnson. And
they are not the group I'm talking about.
That's right.
We're talking about the Hofmann School.
The two schools, actually. Yeah.
The two schools?
Yeah.
Are we going to negate everything of that period? That's ridiculous.
We're talking about two different decades.
The thing about Hofmann that, to me, was so extraordinary is, one, he was a great artist. He was one of the major artists of our time. Two, he got together, for one reason or another, the most talented people, most of the most talented people
here.
At that time. I went there 47 to 49. And there was a climate that was established there. He was at the center of it.
He's
in a sense.
The catalyst of this excitement.
But you learn just as much from other students' ideas, and you learn from him. And he created an atmosphere where to dare was the thing to do.
Right.
Where freedom was very, very important.
I had to work from nature. He would not criticize my work had it not been from the object. I could not bring in a work from my studio and say, and I did.
Oh,
and
really?
And I did, and I would say, Mr. Hofmann, I'd like you to look, I did this at home. And he said, where's the object? And I said, back there in my studio. He said, no way. At that time, when I was there in 37, he would not criticize anybody's work unless it was directly from the object, be it a still life or a model. And the reason for that is he wanted you to be able to experience the object in space as it's related on a two-dimensional plane.
He always had models, you know.
He always had models,
he always had
still life. So we would work on a still life.
He always talked about nature.
Nature. We worked on a still life for 3 months on that one still life.
I have noticed that all the books I read on the New York School, or particularly on abstract expressionism, talk about the same 10 or 12 artists. Yet, the 9th Street show included 61 artists. Now, there are quite a few people then that have not been well documented. The critics have written extensively about abstract expressionism, but they've left out a lot as well.
When you ask why there were only 10 names, maybe not much more, do you feel that this was not true in other disciplines? Do you feel that there was some unstated conspiracy?
I'd like to say it's entrepreneurial. Mm-hmm. Seven or eight have been in the Wright galleries, and one of their paintings come up so an auction. Mm-hmm. There's Leo Castelli, mm-hmm, backing the prices. Mm-hmm. There's Emmerich right there, right?
This is what Stone. Yeah.
You know, and so that, you know, don't ignore that, the entrepreneurial side of it.
I think today, now there's been some renewed interest, but in terms of the younger people, they haven't been taught about any of the other artists, and the information needs to be recorded and brought back into the mainstream of art history, because it's going to get lost otherwise.